So we'll start in a minute. We are live on YouTube. Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue 6U, which is liver and GI pathology. And we are streaming live from Gleneagles Global Hospital, Hyderabad, via Kolkata. And today we have a very, very special topic and a very special person to address the topic. The topic of the day is pathology of liver transplant, the hot thing of the day. And to talk on that, we have Dr. Jyoti Parag Dikate. She is a postgraduate from PGI Chandigarh, a former fellow of GI and liver pathology of the University Health Network Toronto, Canada, consultant GI and hepatobiliary pathology in the Department of Histopathology at Gleneagles Global Hospital, Hyderabad. She's got multiple national and international publications. She is the national expert on liver transplant pathology. Before I ask Dr. Jyoti to take over, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Dr. Jyoti, ma'am, please share your screen and start. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a humble and welcoming introduction. And allowing me to speak on my favorite topic, the topic of my interest, that is the pathology of liver transplantation. Can you see the screen, sir?
Yes, we can see the screen. Just please make it full screen and we'll start. Yeah, fine. Please start. Thank you so much.
All right. So today I will be talking about my topic of interest, that is the pathology of liver transplantation. Certain disclaimers in the beginning. This is how I'm going to go in today's presentation. I will be talking very briefly about the indications of liver transplant, the types of liver transplant, the liver pathology for donor evaluation in liver transplant, and my mainstay of today's talk will be the liver complication in the post-operative period, that is allograft liver complication. Liver transplant is a life-saving option in many of the liver disease, which includes decompensated liver disease, either due to acute or chronic etiologies, which may be due to hepatitic process. The common ones include viral hepatitis, autoimmune hepatitis, biliary process such as PBC, PSC, and alcoholic liver disease, non-alcoholic liver disease, and in a pediatric population, the metabolic liver disorder, and in certain biliary disorders such as biliary atresia, a liver transplant is a life-saving option. In certain primary liver neoplasms such as hepatocellular carcinoma and hepatoblastoma, depending on some clinical criteria like Milan's criteria and UCSF criteria, where depending on the number of lesions and the size of lesions, the patient can be listed for transplant. A very brief thing over the types of liver transplant being performed. The liver donor can be either a cadaver or a live-related liver transplant. So in the cadaver-related liver transplant, the entire liver is being removed and is replaced by healthy donor liver by establishing vascular anastomosis and ductal anastomosis. Split liver donation is another type of cadaver-related liver transplant where the liver is split into two portions, thereby serving the two different recipients. In live-related liver transplant, the portion of liver is being removed and is transplanted to the recipient. Because of the immense potential, regenerative potential of the liver will regain its size within a few weeks' time. Now coming over the pathology of liver transplantation, we get liver biopsy, the core biopsies, in cases when the definitive diagnosis is required, before listing them for transplantation. This is important because there are certain disorders which can reoccur in the post-operative period. So one must know what is the exact indication of transplant. So in certain situations, liver biopsies are performed in these cases. Then for donor evaluation, donor biopsies can either be performed preoperatively when the enzymes levels are high, or there is certain mass lesion which is being detected incidentally in the donor, or intraoperatively there is increased role of frozen biopsy evaluation to assess the suitability of the donor liver. Once the liver once the transplant happens, the explanted liver is sent to histopathology lab for meticulous examination. And most importantly, in the post-transplant setting, liver biopsies, allograft biopsies are being routinely sent because liver biopsy remains the gold standard for making certain diagnoses like rejection, as we will see later in my slides. So for donor evaluation, now intraoperative frozen section is widely used to assess the suitability of the donor. So this is being increased due to the inclusion of this extended criteria donor, also called as marginal donor. Marginal donors are those which has one or other risk factor which can lead to early graft dysfunction, like elderly age, or the patient which are found to have, the prospective donors which are found to have, steatotic liver on imaging. So in these cases, intraoperative frozen section is widely used. This is in order to increase the liver pool and to overcome the shortage of the liver. The preferred sample which is sent to histopathology lab is a 2 cm long needle biopsy, which is commonly sent in routine practice from the anterior inferior portion of the liver. And in some centers, wedge biopsy is being also sent. This has to be preferably sent in a sterile container without any preservative, as it lead to many artifactual changes, thereby leading to the wrong interpretation of the biopsy changes. And it should be sent quickly to the lab to avoid air drying, and use of gauze or cotton should be avoided. It may lead to leaching out of the fat and several other artifactual changes, thereby leading to the wrong interpretation of the biopsy changes. So what are the parameters that we assess during frozen section examination? So in case of frozen section evaluation, we assess for steatosis, the presence of fat, quantification of the fat, which is the most common indication which in routine practice. Then in case of hepatitis, the known case of viral hepatitis, a biopsy can be sent to assess the grade or the stage of fibrosis. Or liver necrosis can also be seen in some of the biopsies, especially in the patient who prospective donor who are cardiac death donors. Then in case of any incidental mass lesion which is found during retrieval, for suspicious lesions, malignancy, these factors can also be assessed in the frozen section examination. This is the proposed criteria to assess the suitability of the organ, and it has been found that macrovesicular fat, if it is involving less than 30% of the liver parenchyma, necrosis involving less than 10% of the liver area, the granulomas, if at all they are calcified and not the active granuloma, less degree of viral hepatitis grade and stage, they generally do favorable in the post-operative stage without much early allograft dysfunction. This slide is to show various types of fatty change which one can see under the microscope. The macrovesicular fatty change, where there are these fat droplets which are there in the hepatocyte cytoplasm with peripherally pushed indented nucleus. This is the small droplet steatosis. Some people also call them mediovesicular steatosis, where there are these multiple lipid droplets within the hepatocytic cytoplasm, but the nucleus is well within the center of the cell. This is what is called as microvesicular fatty change, where there are these multiple lipid droplets within the cytoplasm of the hepatocytes with centrally placed nucleus, and this is kind of imparting a foamy look to the cells. So in the context of liver transplantation for donor evaluation, this is macrovesicular steatosis which is most important, and we must comment very carefully about the percentage of fat. So again, re-emphasizing correct interpretation of the empty spaces as fat, here we can see that in this slide, we see a lot of empty spaces, which some of them looks like fat. But on high power, we can see some of them are actually fat as they are within the cytoplasm with peripherally indented nucleus, which is seen here. But some of the spaces, they are kind of irregular. This is because of the freezing artifact, and this should not be quantified or misinterpreted as fat, thereby leading to the discarding of a otherwise acceptable organ. Once liver transplant is being done, the explanted liver is subjected to histopathology. So when we receive the specimen, we weigh it, we measure it, we serially slice it at 1 centimeter regular interval and look for any specific lesions. We look at the vessels, we look at the ducts, and in case we find some lesions, the mass lesions, the number of lesions should be noted, the size of the lesion should be noted, the presence or absence of macrovascular invasion should be noted, large vessel invasion should be noted, and we should meticulously involve all the important findings in our histopathology report. Now coming over to the main topic of the day, that is the allograft pathology. This is the list of the complications which one see in the post-operative course after liver transplantation. The common ones include the preservation reperfusion injury, rejection, complications related to the vascular abnormality, vascular anastomosis, then biliary complication. The original disease may reoccur in the post-operative period. The liver may acquire some de novo disease like de novo viral hepatitis or certain other conditions. As these patients are on increased immunosuppression throughout, and especially during the early post-operative period, these are prone to develop infections. And PTLD is another very uncommon but a known complication of liver transplantation. So in histopathology lab, when do we receive biopsies in the post-transplant period? Well, we receive them either as a part of protocol biopsies or event-driven biopsies. Protocol biopsies means the biopsies are being done in some centers at certain particular interval. Like in some of the centers at the time of reperfusion, including in our center at Gleneagles Global Hospital, we do receive at the time zero biopsy. So whenever later on there is any allograft complication, one can always go back and look at the native liver biopsy and can compare the changes. In certain centers, the annual biopsies are being performed in particular setting, like the patients who are transplanted for hepatitis C virus or NAFLD. And also in long-term survivors, in some of the centers, biopsies are being done at some particular interval, like 1 year, 5 years or 10 years after transplantation. In practical situations, most of the biopsies are being received are event-driven biopsies, which are received either when there is elevation in the liver enzymes or the patient develop any sign or symptom of liver disease like jaundice or portal hypertensive features or ascites or any abnormalities being detected on imaging or radiology. When we receive biopsies in histopathology lab, one must be aware of this very important piece of information which helps us to arrive at a particular and correct diagnosis. So first is timing after transplantation, which is very, very important because there are certain complications which happens early in the post-operative period, which is roughly described as less than 2 months in context of liver transplantation. And certain other complications, they occur later in the post-operative period, that is after 6 months of transplant. One must be aware of the original indication of the liver transplant and the type of liver transplant. Why type of liver transplant? Because certain complications related to the surgical anastomosis, some vascular complication and biliary complication, they are more prone to happen in the living-related liver transplant. The status of immunosuppression, whether the patient is adequately immunosuppressed, whether he is compliant to the treatment, as we will see later in my slides when we will deal with the practical problems. the trend of the liver enzymes, whether it is a new abnormality or the patient is already diagnosed with certain condition and is not really responding well to the treatment. So one must be aware of the trend of the liver enzyme rather than the enzyme level at that particular point of time. Or any imaging findings if they are relevant in context of liver allograft biopsy interpretation. This is just to show the complications which happens in the early post-operative period and in the late post-operative period. In the early post-operative period, that is in within first 2 months, these are preservation reperfusion injury, small for size syndrome, the antibody mediated rejection, though uncommon but can happen, the acute cellular rejection. These are the major complication which usually happens in the early post-operative period. In the late post-operative period, that is after 6 months, there are more chances of chronic rejection or the recurrent disease. Patient may develop complications related to the vascular abnormality like hepatic artery thrombosis, which peaks in the early post-operative period. Now, starting with our first complication, the preservation reperfusion injury. This is a complication which happens, which is acquired or the damage happens to the liver during the process of harvesting the organ, preserving it and re-implanting into recipient's body. So what exactly happens? When the organ is there in the donor, the vascular supply is shut down. It is cut off to retrieve the donor. So it is there in the at body temperature, but it suffers a brief episode of warm ischemia. After the retrieval, the liver is preserved in a preservation fluid in cold temperature to reduce the metabolic requirements of the liver. And it suffers a brief event of cold ischemia damage. Then again, the liver is brought down to normal physiological temperature so that it is ready to be implanted into the recipient's body. Again, there is a brief episode of warm ischemia. And later on, there is resumption of the blood flow by re-establishing the vascular anastomosis when there is injury to the endothelial compartment of the liver, leading to the reperfusion injury. During this time, the Kupffer cells, the sinusoidal endothelial cells of the liver, they get activated and the damage happens in the liver. During the warm ischemia time, the hepatocytes, they are more susceptible to be damaged. And during the cold ischemia time, it is important to remember these are the bile ducts and the endothelial cells which are more susceptible. During the reperfusion injury, it is the microvascular department of the liver which is more prone to damage and more susceptible to damage. So it is being noted that warm ischemia event, if it is sustained less than 120 minutes and cold ischemia time when it is sustained less than 10 hours, it will not cause much damage to the liver and will result only in mild elevation of the liver enzymes or maybe bilirubin, which will settle down in due course of time within 48 hours to 7 days and the bilirubin will normalize. However, in cases where the marginal donors are being used, like the steatotic graft, in those cases there can be graft dysfunction, particularly when the warm ischemia time and the cold ischemia time is being prolonged. So how do clinicians recognize these cases of early graft dysfunction? In the early post-operative period, they will have poor bile flow. They will have increased lactate levels and there will be marked elevation in the liver enzymes level. So this is a photomicrograph where we can see that this is a central vein and these are perivenular group of hepatocytes. So as we see here, the hepatocytes here look swollen as compared to the zone 2 hepatocytes. Okay, this is zone 3, this is zone 2. So in zone 3, the hepatocytes, they look swollen and the cytoplasm is kind of rarefied here. They look ballooned. This is another photomicrograph, the hyperview where the hepatocytes are kind of ballooned here and one can see this cholestasis. So central lobular cholestasis and central lobular hepatocytic swelling is a common finding one can see in early post-operative period. This is because of ischemic preservation reperfusion injury, which happens in cases where the graft is severely injured. The patient who has got graft from marginal donors or extended criteria donor, or the ischemic time is being prolonged beyond the optimal, one may see lot of parenchymal necrosis, which is mostly seen in the perivenular area, and later on they can be panlobular necrosis. So in such cases, when the necrosis is widespread, one must think of the other differential diagnosis, which is hepatic artery thrombosis. And to differentiate the Doppler studies and the CT angiographic studies, they are of immense help. Also, the centrolobular hepatocytic swelling and centrolobular cholestasis is a feature one sees in early cases of biliary obstruction as well as in sepsis. So there are certain pointers histologically where we can confidently diagnose either of these entities, though they share certain common features. The presence of neutrophilic predominant inflammation in cases of biliary obstruction, the presence of edema, the presence of intraepithelial and intraductal neutrophils favors biliary obstruction or cholangitis rather than preservation injury. The ductular reaction, it is a late feature of biliary obstruction, which is not usually seen in the early phase. However, one may see this feature also in cases of biliary obstruction. Now, coming over to the another very important allograft complication, the rejection, where the biopsy remains the mainstay, the gold standard for making the diagnosis. Rejection indicates the host or recipient's immune response against the foreign donor antigen. There are four forms of rejection which are being described and recognized. The typical T-cell mediated rejection, which is the most common form of rejection seen in routine practice, mostly in the early post-operative period. The antibody mediated rejection is uncommon, rather very rare in cases of liver transplant. Plasma cell rich rejection and chronic rejection is a form of rejection which is usually seen in the later post-operative period, that is after 6 months. Now coming over to the most common form of rejection seen in liver allograft recipients, the typical T-cell mediated rejection, previously also called as acute cellular rejection. The incidence of acute cellular rejection is really high, being reported as like almost 50% of the cases they will suffer from one or the other episodes of acute cellular rejection, mostly in the first month of post-transplantation. These patients will have increased transaminases level, the ALP, ALT, AST all will be elevated, and there will be elevation in the GGT levels. Why elevation in the gamma-glutamyl transpeptidase? Because it is an enzyme which is usually released or secreted whenever there is injury to the or damage to the ductal epithelium. The targets for typical T-cell mediated rejection are the bile duct epithelium and the endothelial cells of the portal veins and central veins. This is a high-power view of a portal area which is involved by this episode of typical T-cell mediated rejection. So here we can see that this is the portal vein, the bile duct and the accompanying hepatic artery branch and the portal stroma. So the portal stroma here shows these kind of mixed inflammatory cells which are composed of these lymphomononuclear cells, many eosinophils. This is a consistent finding which we usually see in cases of typical T-cell mediated rejection, and the presence of these larger cells. So these larger cells, they are definitely larger than the adjacent mature appearing lymphocytes. They have kind of vesicular or dispersed nuclear chromatin. These are also called as, because of their morphological phenotype, they are also called as activated or blastoid lymphocyte in the context of liver transplantation rejection. So this is the typical inflammatory milieu, the presence of mixed inflammatory cells with lymphomononuclear cells, many eosinophils, neutrophils, macrophages, blastoid lymphocyte, which one must appreciate. This is a typical inflammatory milieu of typical T-cell mediated rejection. So as we see here, that this infiltrate, it is lying under the endothelium of portal vein, and leading to the uplifting or hobnailing of the endothelial cells at places. This is the portal vein injury, which is termed as phlebitis or portal endothelialitis in context of rejection in liver transplant cases. The bile duct, as we see here, is infiltrated by some of these lymphomononuclear cells. Probably here there is an eosinophil which is kind of infiltrating into the epithelium. So this is a bile duct injury. So there is a triad here which is going on: the mixed inflammatory cells in the stroma, the portal phlebitis, and bile duct damage which is happening, and it is a typical triad of typical T-cell mediated rejection, previously called as acute cellular rejection in liver transplant cases. This is another photomicrograph where again we can see this mixed kind of inflammatory cells with many blastoid lymphocytes, again eosinophil which is consistently seen in cases of rejection, and bile duct injury. So apart here, this is just to appreciate that apart from the infiltration by the inflammatory cells, one may say these kind of degenerative changes. As we see here, there is marked nuclear overlapping, there is uneven spacing between the nuclei, some of the nuclei they look enlarged, there is nucleomegaly. So these are described as degenerative changes, which is again a form of ductal damage which happens in typical T-cell mediated rejection cases. Once we establish a diagnosis of typical T-cell mediated rejection, we must try to grade it. And Banff Working Group has given us this rejection activity index, which is actually used in practice, and it will guide the further management of the patient. Or global assessment is another method to assess the severity of typical T-cell mediated rejection, where the rejection process is graded as mild, moderate, or severe, depending on the intensity of inflammation and intensity of the damage happening to the portal vein and a central vein or the bile duct. So this is the scoring criteria given by Banff Working Group, where each of the component, the portal inflammation, the bile duct damage, and venous endothelial inflammation, whether happening involving the portal vein or the central vein, they are graded on a score of 1 to 3, and a sum total is given. This sum total represents the rejection activity index. The score of 3 to 4 represents mild typical T-cell mediated rejection, 5 to 6 being moderate, and 7 to 9 being severe. This is important because the cases which are diagnosed as mild T-cell mediated rejection, the immunosuppression is being maintained in practical setting, but the steroid boluses or the immunosuppression is not escalated. However, in cases of moderate and severe rejection, the immunosuppression needs to be escalated. Steroid boluses are given to these patients because they have increased risk of progression to chronic rejection. So another important thing here is that in cases of moderate to severe rejection, particularly in the later post-operative period when they are diagnosed after 3 months, one may see a lot of lobular hepatitis going on in these patients. So in these situations, it is important to differentiate them from the viral hepatitis. This is a table just to differentiate. There are morphological indicators where we can differentiate between these two differential diagnoses. It is very, very important to make a correct diagnosis, because in cases of T-cell mediated rejection, one needs to escalate the immunosuppression. However, in cases of viral hepatitis, the one needs to downregulate the immunosuppression levels. So as we see here, the nature of portal inflammation, which is very, very important. In cases of T-cell mediated rejection, it is again the typical mixed inflammatory milieu consisting of activated lymphocytes, eosinophils, neutrophils may or may not be present. In viral hepatitis, the infiltrate tends to be more monotypic with predominance of the lymphocytes. Though one may see interface activity, some lobular inflammation, lobular apoptosis in acute cellular rejection, it is not a predominant finding as one see in cases of viral hepatitis. And again, the presence of phlebitis, bile duct injury, it favors along with the mixed inflammatory portal infiltrate, it favors the diagnosis of T-cell mediated rejection rather than viral hepatitis. And in doubtful cases, one can always take help of the DNA levels, the RNA levels for elucidating the exact cause of the injury. So, I would like to mention here something about the central perivenulitis, which is basically a form of acute cellular rejection only, but it is a morphological phenotype which occurs in the cases who presents with T-cell mediated rejection in the later post-operative period, that is after 3 months. So these patients, they have more of central lobular inflammation associated with zone 3 hepatocellular loss. There is hemorrhage in the perivenular area and there is damage to the central veins. The typical portal features, they are less prominent. The duct injury is less prominent. Portal phlebitis is less prominent in the cases which present in the later post-operative period. So this is one of the higher view of the central vein and the perivenular area. We can see here that the central vein is completely damaged by this dense lymphomononuclear prominent inflammation with extravasation of these RBCs, and there is loss of the perivenular group of hepatocytes. So this is what is called as central perivenulitis, which can be seen either as a component of typical severe typical T-cell mediated rejection in the early post-operative period, or it can present without portal features in the later post-operative period. So how do we approach, like when the portal features they are present, we can clearly establish the diagnosis, but if the portal features they are not conspicuous, so what do we do? So in 1/3 of the biopsies, particularly after 6 months, patient may present with isolated central perivenulitis, and there are certain other conditions which can produce damage to the central lobular area. So it is proposed that, of course, one must go back and check the history, whether the patient already had suffered episodes of rejection in the past or not. If at all patient has suffered rejection rejection episodes in the past, we should look for the compliance of the treatment. We should look at the biopsy findings. It is proposed that if more than 50% of the central vein, along with your clinical cues, if you get them, it is more indicative of rejection-related isolated central perivenulitis. However, if the portal changes are absent, the patient hasn't suffered any episode of rejection in the past, and we see in the biopsy that it is a central perivenulitis, which is the predominant finding. So one must look at the other differential diagnosis as well, like autoimmune hepatitis, chronic viral hepatitis, and PBC. In such cases, the diagnosis has to be established by a correlation with the serological and viral markers parameters. So this is all about typical T-cell mediated rejection. The typical features, one must remember the mixed inflammatory cells, portal vein damage, the bile duct damage, and the central perivenulitis, which is seen in the later post-operative period and in the cases which presents late. Another form of rejection is the chronic rejection, which is again immune-mediated, potentially irreversible damage to the liver allograft. It is seen in almost 3 to 5% of the liver transplant recipients, and it results from the persistent injury and abnormal repair. Injury in cases of chronic rejection is targeted at or directed at the vascular endothelium of the hepatic artery and the peribiliary plexus, as well as the bile duct epithelium. The risk factor for chronic rejection include repeated episodes of acute cellular rejection, any infection or high donor age, or there is suboptimum immunosuppression. In those cases, patient may develop chronic rejection. So in these cases, one must look at the clinical history, which could include, prior multiple episodes of acute cellular rejection episodes or ongoing episodes of acute cellular rejection. Or, in certain cases, patients have problems in attaining the satisfactory levels of immunosuppression. It is either because of the erratic absorption of the drugs or due to certain other factors. Histologically, these cases are characterized by duct injury because of the direct target to the bile duct epithelium or by injury to the peribiliary capillary plexus, which is the major vascular supply of the bile duct branches. Thereby, there is duct injury and there will be duct loss in these cases. Another histological feature is the presence of obliterative vasculopathy, which usually involves the medium and large caliber artery. Since in cold biopsy, we don't see medium and large caliber arteries, our diagnosis mainly is based on the ductal changes which we see in the biopsies. This is a high power view of a portal area where we can see that there is just scant sprinkling of the lymphocytes, maybe some plasma cells here. This is the portal vein, the hepatic artery branch and the bile duct branch. If we look at the bile duct branch here carefully, we can see that nuclei, they are missing here. The cytoplasm, it looks hyper-eosinophilic and definitely it looks abnormal. So these are, these changes, irregular spacing, cytoplasmic hyper-eosinophilia, alteration in the NC ratio, luminal narrowing, these are the features which are described as senescent-related changes or atrophic bile duct changes, which we see in cases of chronic rejection. So we must have adequate number of, portal areas to look at the bile duct epithelial changes. This is another finding which we can see in cases of chronic rejection. The presence of foam cells, these are foamy histiocytes which are there in the sinusoidal spaces. This is another photograph of a hepatic artery which is involved by this rejection episode. Here we can see that there is luminal obliteration. Why there is luminal obliteration? There is intimal thickening. There are a collection of these foamyohistiocytes which are deposited in the media of the hepatic artery branch. So this is the typical obliterative vasculopathy which we see in these cases, and if we are lucky, sometimes we may get them in some of our cases. One may see a pusae of perivenular inflammation, which is usually seen in early phase of chronic rejection. So if we are able to appreciate senescent related changes or evidence of obliterative vasculopathy, and there is duct loss in the right clinical context, one can establish a diagnosis of chronic rejection. And when we know it is a case of chronic rejection, it is important to divide it into early and late phase. Why so? Because these early cases, they are still modifiable, still can be saved by escalated immunosuppression or by introduction of steroids or mTOR inhibitors. These cases can certainly be saved. But the cases who are in the later phase of chronic rejection, in those cases there are higher chances of allograft failure and these patients may be relisted for retransplantation. So whenever we see any duct damage or duct loss which is happening in the biopsy, one must think of the other differential diagnosis, which includes biliary stricture. We can surely and comfortably exclude it, because in chronic rejection, the ductular proliferation, the ductular response, which is commonly seen in biliary stricture, it is missing. We don't see ductular proliferation in cases of chronic rejection. We just see the senescent ductal degenerative changes and the duct loss. And the neutrophilic predominant inflammation, the periductal edema, they are not seen in cases of chronic rejection but are seen in cases of biliary stricture. Another differential diagnosis, if the patient is being transplanted for sclerosing cholangitis, one must think of recurrent episode of sclerosing cholangitis. Certain drugs, I have seen few cases where, some antibiotics, they can be associated with vanishing bile duct disease, and one must think and elucidate the history of any recent drug exposure before this diagnosis is being made. So this is a practical problem in cases who are transplanted for PSC in the later phase to differentiate them from chronic rejection, because both of these processes, they involve the ducts. The chronic rejection, it usually occurs in the first years of transplantation, while cases of recurrent PSC, they tend to happen years after transplantation. The typical portal features of PSC, as we do see in the native liver biopsies, include the presence of mixed inflammatory cells, periductal edema, pericholangitis. These are not the features one sees in chronic rejection. And also, the central perivenulitis, central perivenular lobular inflammation, one can see in early phase of chronic rejection, but it is not a feature of PSC. Cholangiography in doubtful cases really helps us in making the diagnosis because of the characteristic findings of PSC, including the beading, the pruning, mural irregularities, and outpouching of the epithelium. So by appropriate clinical, pathological, and cholangiographic correlation, in cases of recurrent PSC, doubtful cases of recurrent PSC, one can differentiate it confidently from chronic rejection. So another variant of rejection is plasma cell-rich rejection, which is seen in the later postoperative period. This was previously called as plasma cell hepatitis or de novo autoimmune hepatitis. As the name indicates, there will be plasma cells. So this is a rejection entity which is diagnosed in the patients who are transplanted for etiologies other than autoimmune hepatitis. It represents mixed T cell mediated rejection and antibody mediated rejection etiology. The patients previously who were treated with HCV, they are the risk with interferons, are at risk factor for developing plasma cell rich rejection. They are characterized by abnormal liver enzymes, and they will have many plasma cells. So the histological features are similar to autoimmune hepatitis. It is important because to diagnose this entity, because if not treated in time, this will lead to rapid graft failure and loss. So this is the criteria which is being given by BAMP working group in 2016 for diagnosing this plasma cell rich rejection, where the majority of the infiltrate is composed of plasma cell. That is, at least 30% of the infiltrate should composed of the plasma cells within the portal areas or in the perivenular areas. And the original disease must be other than autoimmune hepatitis. Okay, so these two criteria, the first and third, one are the absolute criteria which are required to diagnose these cases. Lymphocytic cholangitis is usually seen in these cases in practical settings. It is a desirable criteria according to a BAM working group and not absolutely required to make this diagnosis. So one may also take help of IHC, because in these cases one may see a deposition of the C4D complement in the microvasculature department, and the serum IgG levels, they are elevated in these cases. This is the photomicrograph where we can see that this portal area is widely expanded with lot of interface activity with plasma cell rich infiltrate. And again, we can see the interface activity here. This is not a very common form of rejection in practical setting. It is the T cell mediated rejection and chronic rejection, which we usually see in practical settings. This is a very uncommon type of rejection. Now coming over to the antibody mediated rejection, which is again very uncommon, rather very rare, seen in liver allograft recipient. The ABO incompatible, the patients who are transplanted with ABO incompatible, undergoes ABO incompatible transplant, they are more susceptible for this kind of rejection, the antibody mediated rejection. And the susceptibility of the patient for developing antibody mediated rejection is dependent on the antibody class, the titers, the specificity, the timing, the density, and the target antigen distribution. So in cases where there is IgM and IgG isoagglutinin titers and complement fixing ability, it influences the pathogenic potential, and recipients who have more than 1:64 titers of isoagglutinins, they often manifest graft dysfunction and histopathological damage. this is to understand the pathophysiology of antibody-mediated rejection, why it is uncommon in cases of liver transplant allograft recipients. It is because the expression of blood group antigen, the AB, and class 1 antigen, they are kind of ubiquitously expressed all over the endothelial surface of the liver, including the liver sinusoidal endothelial cells, the monocyte phagocytic system, the Kupffer cells, the stellate cells, the dendritic cells, hepatic artery, portal vein, central vein, they are ubiquitously expressed, the blood group antigen and class 1 antigen. But class 2 antigen, they are expressed only on few cell types. By immunophenotyping or immunohistochemistry, it has been found that they are expressed on the portal microvasculature. Okay, so these are not, under normal circumstances, they are not expressed on the other cell types. But when there is any inflammatory stimulus, the expression of MHC class 2 antigen, it is induced in the other compartments of the liver endothelial cells, and also the immune expression is heightened in the portal microvasculature. So if there are these antibodies which are in low titers present in the pre-transplant setting, they are these immune complexes, because of the presence of these Kupffer cells, these liver sinusoidal endothelial cells, they are mopped off. Okay, so because of the large size of the liver, the antigen binding, antibody binding sites along the endothelial surface is being diluted, and they are less prone to damage. This is to understand the portal microvasculature, since I am using this term again and again, and to understand the histopathological changes, one must know what is portal microvasculature. Here we can see that this is the three-dimensional diagram of the hepatic lobule, where there is central vein in the middle, the portal tracts at the periphery in the interfaces. The hepatic artery branch, which is also called as axial artery, accompanies the bile duct in all the portal areas, and it gives off a branch to the portal stroma, which is called as portal stromal capillaries. It gives off a branch to the bile duct, which is called as peribiliary artery. This peribiliary artery, it forms a complex mesh network around the bile duct structures, which is called as peribiliary capillary plexus, to supply the bile duct. And also this axial artery or the hepatic artery branch gives branches to the portal vein, and also form arteriovenous connection here at the interface, supplying the lobule. The cases of antibody mediated rejection, which is more common in ABO incompatible transplant, they are manifested clinically by the low complement levels, thrombocytopenia, and on histopathology, the signature histopathological finding is the presence of portal microvasculitis. So as the name suggests, this portal microvasculature, which I have shown previously, these structures, these stromal capillaries, peribiliary capillary plexus, and the teeny branches which are supplying the portal veins, they are kind of dilated. The capillaries are dilated. There will be enlargement of the endothelium, along with margination and sludging of the inflammatory cells. Most commonly seen are the monocytes, neutrophils, and eosinophils. So the changes are usually seen in portal veins, the portal capillaries, and the inlet venules. In severe cases of antibody-mediated rejection, one may see disruption of the microvasculature with extravasation of RBC and fibrin deposition. Other portal changes which are usually seen in cases of antibody-mediated rejection includes the presence of neutrophilic predominant inflammation, presence of cholangitis, and ductular reaction. One must also look for the complement deposition in these cases to establish the diagnosis. And in the context of liver transplantation, the C4D positivity is described as luminal positivity, either linear or granular, along the portal microvasculature, involving more than 50% of the circumference of the portal microvasculature. This is the high power view, where we can see this is the bile duct, and these are the pericapillary biliary plexus. So these capillary plexuses, which are otherwise not seen in cases of normal biopsies, they are kind of dilated here, and we can see that the endothelium here is prominent and some of the inflammatory cells, they are marginated. Another photomicrograph where we can see that the septal venules here, they are kind of dilated here with hobnailing of the endothelium, and there is margination of the inflammatory cells within the lumen. In severe cases, one can see disruption of the microvasculature. So this is a photomicrograph where we can see again these dilated microvasculature or the portal capillaries, the marginations of the inflammatory cells, the monocytoid cells, and there is disruption of the microvasculature resulting in RBC extravasation and hemorrhage into the portal spaces. So this is how C4D looks in cases of antibody mediated rejection. So here we can see that definitely it is involving more than 50% of the circumference of the portal microvasculature. So one may see a linear positivity or a granular positivity. If at all it is present in the right context of histological findings, it is interpreted as positive. So this is what BAMF working group has recommended to score the histopathological findings of microvasculitis on a score of 1 to 3 and C4D deposition on a score of 0 to 3. Depending on the degree of microvasculitis, it is being scored, and degree and the number of portal areas which are involved, C4D score is being given. To establish a diagnosis of antibody-mediated rejection, one must see number 3 C4D score, that is, there is more than 50% of the portal areas, they will show C4D positivity with extension into the periportal sinusoids. In cases of ABO incompatible transplant, the portal stromal positivity for C4D is also a very peculiar finding. So this is what is being proposed by BAMF working group in 2016. That to make a definitive diagnosis of antibody mediated rejection, one must see all these four features along with histopathology, C4D score, there should be positive serum DSA levels, and the early causes of the allograft dysfunction must be excluded. So this is all about the major rejection processes involving the liver, the typical T-cell mediated rejection, the plasma cell rich rejection, the chronic rejection, and antibody mediated rejection. Now moving on to the other important complication, which is not so common, but it is a dreadful complication seen in the post-operative period, the vascular complications. The hepatic artery thrombosis is one of the worrisome and fearful complications seen in cases of hepatic liver transplantation. Hepatic artery flow can be compromised either due to thrombosis, which is usually seen in the early postoperative period, and later also due to the kinking of the artery or the stenosis of the artery. It results in graft failure and it is a cause of high mortality in liver transplant recipients. The risk factors include the surgical causes, the hypercoagulable state of the recipient, and the prolongation of the cold ischemia time. As we have already seen, the Doppler findings and the CT angiography remains the mainstay for the diagnosis of this. This is one of the gross photographs which I have taken from this Romil Saxena book, where we can see that this is an explanted, this is a liver, slice of the liver, where there are these areas of necrosis which are bordered by these hyperemic areas. So these, this liver parenchyma is kind of necrosed here, which can be confirmed by histopathological examination. The periportal, this is a portal tract here, the periportal group of hepatocytes, they are kind of preserved. However, there is extensive necrosis in the zone 3 and zone 2. So if you remember in my first complication, preservation reperfusion injury, we saw this kind of picture where the severe cases may present with a similar injury type. So in these cases, the Doppler findings and CT angiography will remain the mainstay for diagnosis. Moving on to the another complication, small for size syndrome, also called as portal hyperperfusion syndrome. It is a complication that occurs primarily in living donor or reduced size liver allografts. It occurs when the transplanted donor segment is less than 30% of the expected or standard liver volume of the recipient or less than 0.8% of the recipient body weight. That is, when a transplanted liver is not large enough to accommodate the markedly increased portal vein blood flow. So most of the patients which are transplanted, they usually suffer from cirrhosis or one of the other, or they compensate in the form of portal hypertension. So to understand the pathophysiology of small for size syndrome, it is important to know this hepatic artery buffer response. Basically, this buffer response, it regulates a balanced portal vein and hepatic artery inflow. There is a reciprocal regulation between portal vein and hepatic artery inflow. So whenever there is increased portal venous pressure, the hepatic artery flow will be diminished. This is because there is a constant release of a vasodilator substance in the blood, which is called as adenosine. So whenever there is increased portal flow, the local concentration of the adenosine will reduce, which will result in the hepatic artery branch constriction and result reduction in the arterial flow. This is what is observed in cases of portal hyperperfusion syndrome or small for size syndrome liver allografts. Converse happens when there is diminished flow in the portal vasculature. There will be increased concentration of this vasodilator substance, adenosine, which results in the dilatation of the hepatic artery. So this low adenosine concentration due to increased portal flow results in the reduced flow of the hepatic artery or vasoconstriction of the hepatic artery is the pathophysiological basis of small for size syndrome. The features of small for size syndrome may be divided into early or late. So in early findings, there will be portal hyperperfusion because of the increased blood flow in the portal veins, so resulting in the hemorrhage in the portal areas and in the periportal areas, and also the parenchymal infarcts. In severe cases, there can be functional de-arterialization and resulting in the ischemic cholangitis. The late sequel is seen in cases that survive the earlier insults, and they will present with, they may have developed these nodular regenerative hyperplastic changes and also biliary strictures. So these are the changes which we usually don't see. These are the changes which we usually we don't see on the peripheral needle biopsy. In the peripheral needle biopsy or the core biopsy we receive in the routine practice, there is a classical triad of small for size syndrome where we see centrilobular hepatocanalicular cholestasis, there will be centrilobular microvesicular steatosis, and there will be presence of the ductular reaction. Moving on to another complication of the in the liver allograft recipients, the biliary complications. So, the ductal anastomosis in cases of liver transplant, either they are maintained by establishment of the colo-doco-jejunal anastomosis or by duct-to-duct anastomosis. There are a lot of complications which can happen in context of biliary complication, including the surgical by leaks, biliary sludge syndrome, there can be stricture, and there can be ischemic changes in the bile duct epithelium. Bile leak is an anastomotic complication. Biliary sludge syndrome is usually a sequel of prolonged cold ischemic reperfusion injury. This happens because in cold ischemic preservation injury, we saw that this is the endothelial damage and the bile duct damage which happens. So what happens is that there will be depletion of energy stores in the bile duct epithelium and microvasculature of the supplying the bile duct. This results in damage to the biliary epithelial cells, which are sloughed off into the bile. Because of this sloughing of the epithelial cells, the underlying stroma, it is exposed to bile, which serves as a nidus for crystallization of the biliary sludge. So these cases, they present with hyperbilirubinemia, and this is a complication which is seen in long reperfusion graft injury. So the morphological changes produced by biliary sludge syndrome, they are present in the extrahepatic large bile duct and intrahepatic large bile duct. However, we receive only the core biopsies from the periphery, where we see the sequel because of the obstruction, that is, there will be ductular reaction with myofibroblastic proliferation in the stroma. Also, bile ducts can develop stricture either at the anastomotic site, which is because of the surgical complication, which is usually seen in the early post-operative period. But the non-anastomotic strictures are also well-known complication in cases of liver transplant setting. It is because of hepatic artery thrombosis in the late sequel, that is, when there is kinking of the hepatic artery, or also in cases of ischemic reperfusion injury because of the damage to the pericapillary biliary plexus. This is a high-power view of a portal area which looks irregular. We can see that there is pale appearance of the stroma because of the edema. There is mixed inflammatory cells with some neutrophils, and there is periductal edema, some ductular proliferation. These are the changes we see usually in early case, in cases of duct obstruction in the early period. However, in later period, the edema subsides and there is more of fibrosis in the portal stroma, along with the other changes like ductular proliferation, neutrophilic predominant infiltrate. The cases of biliary stricture can also be complicated by inflammatory processes resulting in ascending cholangitis, which is seen histologically as the presence of inflammatory cells within the epithelium or within the lumen of the bile duct. So this is in brief about the biliary complication and the vascular complications seen after liver transplantation. The liver may also, the original disease can also come back in the post-operative period, which is usually seen as a late allograft complication, which develops after 6 months or 1 year of transplantation. And the disease which can recur includes the cases of viral hepatitis, autoimmune hepatitis, autoimmune liver disease. The presence of the NASH can also recur if the metabolic requirements are not taken care of. However, the fantastic thing in cases of pediatric liver transplant, when they are done in cases of metabolic liver disease, are the underlying genetic defect, it tends to be cured. So the histological findings of these recurrent disease will be same as we see in the native liver biopsies. So hence, I am not mentioning them here. However, I would like to mention about this particular reinfection, an aggressive reinfection, which is usually seen in cases of liver transplantation in the early post-operative period, called as fibrosing cholestatic hepatitis. It is an atypical aggressive form of reinfection when seen in early months of liver transplantation, when the levels of immunosuppression are at highest. It leads to graft failure very, very rapidly and is associated with massive viral replication. So since these patients are at immunosuppression, they are not able to mount the response. Hence, the histological findings will be different as we see in other cases of viral infection. There will be panlobular hepatocellular swelling. There will be cholestasis, ductular proliferation, a very peculiar fibrosis pattern called as perisinusoidal fibrosis pattern, and of course, lack of significant inflammation. This is a photomicrograph where we can see that the entire lobule here, the hepatocytes, they are swollen here. There is extensive canalicular cholestasis. The portal areas, they look irregular. This is the Mason trichrome stain where we can appreciate that there are these strands of fibrosis which are insinuating in the perisinusoidal space called as perisinusoidal pattern of fibrosis. One can also take help of immunostain like CK7 or CK19 to to highlight the ductular proliferation. So whenever we see any ductular proliferation, one must always think of biliary obstruction also. However, the finding of this hepatocellular swelling, it is very typical of and hepatocellular swelling, which is seen throughout the liver parenchyma, along with the perisinusoidal typical pattern of fibrosis. This is very typical of fibrosing cholestatic hepatitis. And these patients, they will have very high liver enzymes. They will be in thousands. And the DNA levels, RNA levels will be in 10 logs or more. So again here, the presence of portal edema, cholangitis, it favors more of biliary obstruction. However, the ballooning of the hepatocytes, it favors more of fibrosing cholestatic hepatitis. The presence of perisinusoidal fibrosis, typically seen in cases of fibrosing cholestatic hepatitis. In cases of FCH. So this is very brief about all the complications of liver transplantation. So I would like to end my discussion here with these take-home messages. The successful interpretation of liver allograft biopsy, it depends on the specimen adequacy, familiarity with the timings and the clinical context, working knowledge of the differential diagnosis, and understanding the clinical implication of every diagnosis. How we can do that? By closely interacting with the liver team, knowing about the clinical details, knowing about the imaging findings. T-cell mediated rejection is the most common form of rejection, usually seen in the first 3 months, characterized by mixed portal inflammatory infiltrate, phlebitis, and duct damage. Antibody mediated rejection is very, very rare in liver allograft setting, and strict criteria must be employed to diagnose this entity. Atypical features in the form of central perivenolitis may be seen in late cases, and other causes of central perivenolitis must be excluded to make a correct diagnosis. The disease may recur. Some of the common ones include viral hepatitis, and some of the findings may overlap with rejection. Because of the treatment implications, one has to closely work with the clinical team to make a correct diagnosis. Fibrosing cholestatic hepatitis is an aggressive form of recurrent HCV or HBV, where an early diagnosis is very, very important, so that early treatment is instituted and the patient doesn't lose the graft. With this, I would like to end my talk, and I am really indebted to my PGI faculty, and I am really grateful to my faculty at ULHN Toronto, Dr. Rajkumar Vajpayee, Professor Ranjan Chetty in particular, Dr. Delhi, Dr. Sandra Fisher, who were hepatopathologists back then. This was my department there at UHN Toronto, Dr. Vajpayee, Dr. Chetty, Delhi, Eva Zen Georgie, Sandra Fisher, Stefano, and Young Miko. Yeah, this was at USCAP 2015, back then, when I was doing my fellowship. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jyoti Dikat. The excellent presentation, so crisp and clear and so confident. You can just stop presenting so that we can see you. And there are a lot of questions on the YouTube. Mm-hmm. Would you like to take them?
Sure, sir.
I have sent you on the WhatsApp, on your WhatsApp, some of the screenshots of the questions. If you have your phone around, then you can read and answer them one by one.
I'll do that.
Yeah, you can stop presenting so that we can see you. You can just open your video.
So the first question here is, liver transplant from disease.
Put your video on. You can just put your video on.
Sure, sir.
Yeah, great.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, fine, yeah.
So the first question here is, liver transplant from diseased donor. Two lobes can be used for two recipients. Yes, I mean it depends on the volume of the liver. In cases of cadaver-related liver transplant, the two lobes or the point of the interface at which it is going to happen is described by the vascular anatomy, which is done by, this is a job which is done by the surgical team and the clinical team. And yes, two lobes can be used for two different recipients. Chances of CMV infection in the post-transplant period. Yes, so these patients usually are at increased risk of developing opportunistic infection, and CMV is one of them. But in routine practice, since these patients are already on prophylaxis, so we don't see them very often in the routine practice, but they are definitely at increased risk of developing CMV infection as well. Another is incidence of post-transplant fibrosis and post-transplant cirrhosis in percentage. All right. So post-transplant fibrosis, if we talk about fibrosis in the post-transplant period, particularly this is seen in the later post-operative period, that is after 1 year of the transplantation. And there are several things which are going on. There are several studies which are going on this topic. Like the chronic antibody-mediated rejection, which I haven't spoken about it in today's talk, because the criteria are just putative. They are probable, but they are not really definitive. So de novo DSA can develop, and they may result in fibrosis. In fact, idiopathic fibrosis is one of the long-term complications seen in the post-liver transplant recipients. The exact percentage, I'm not really sure. But yes, they can be seen, but exact percentage I'm not really sure, sir. So because these will require, long-term studies in the patients, and there are studies which are going on in the pediatric population, because these patients, they have less chances of, disease recurrence, since most of the patients in pediatric population, they are being transplanted for biliary atresia or one of the other metabolic disorders. So there are those long-term studies which are going on. It is difficult to say the exact percentage at this point of time. All right, so another question here is, what are the risks of living donor liver transplantation? So as I already mentioned, in the context of pathology, in living donor liver transplantation, there are more chances of having bile duct complications. Because of anastomosis, there are more chances of this vascular complication. So definitely LDLT, the small for size syndrome, if the weight volume of the liver is less than they expected, they have more chances of developing this small for size syndrome or portal hyperperfusion syndrome. So definitely they are certainly at risk of having more complication than the cadaver-related transplant. So another question I have got here is, how many central veins are mandatory to diagnose central perivenularitis to differentiate between recurrent HCV from late acute cellular rejection, because both show central perivenularitis. Yeah, so as I mentioned that in these cases, when we see only isolated central perivenularitis, we must always go back and look at the history, whether patient had already suffered episode of rejection previously or not, whether they are adequately immunosuppressed by checking the TAC levels, the tacrolimus levels. And we can always, look at the compliance of the patient to the treatment. If at all you are looking at a biopsy, I mean, there is no strict criteria per se in terms of, how many central veins are required to have central perivenularitis. There is no strict criteria per se. You have to clinically correlate it, looking at the compliance of the patient to the drugs, looking at the immunosuppression levels, which whether they are maintained in the patient or not. And of course, in all the possibilities, if at all your AC, this recurrent HCV is high on the card, one must always correlate it with the RNA levels, and the molecular techniques and the serological levels. So yeah, this is how we differentiate. But mostly in cases when we have this portal features its mandate is only isolated central perivenulitis, which is not very common. 1/3 of the patient may have isolated central perivenulitis. One must go back and check at the clinical context. One must look check back at the compliance of the patient, and this all can give you answer whether you are dealing with a process which is rejection related or recurrent HCV related. Another question I have here is, how to differentiate resolving LAR from chronic rejection in liver biopsy? So late acute cellular rejection, in late acute cellular rejection, we see more of central perivenular changes. That is, in zone 3, we have more of inflammation, we have central lobular perivenular loss of hepatocytes. But in cases of chronic rejection, the diagnosis rests on the senescent changes in the bile duct epithelium, which is a feature which we look at in the portal areas and not in the central lobular areas. Though central lobular inflammation can be seen in early phases of chronic rejection, the senescent or the degenerative atrophic changes in the bile duct, this is a feature which we usually see in cases of chronic rejection and not in cases of late acute cellular rejection. But remember, this chronic rejection and this late acute cellular rejection, they are not distinct processes. This is an evolving phenomena, and there may be a significant overlap. You have to really go back, look at the number of portal areas, look at how many ducts are undergoing senescent related changes, atrophic changes, and then you compare the findings and arrive at a particular diagnosis. Any more questions, sir?
No. Baat ho gaya. And you have really answered them so well. I'm feeling so proud that you are here, and you are really an expert in liver transplant pathology. We can see that, and the way you have handled all the questions so very nicely, excellent. I wish I can give you a standing ovation.
Oh my God! Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Brilliantly
done. Years, I'm giving a talk. Please forgive me if I have done some silly mistakes.
No silly mistakes. You've done so well. Excellent. What confidence! My God, everybody will feel proud. I wish Rajda would see this. He would feel. We will share the YouTube recording with you. You can share with him. He will feel really proud. Thank you so much, Dr. Jyoti. Excellently done. Very well. Super. You really made us proud. So see you with your, slide seminar sometime later this month.
Sure. Yeah,
we'll be really waiting for that. Thank you so much. God bless you. Good night. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Order for it.